even though GA4 is very new, you still need to know if it's set up correctly. And that's where our audit dashboard comes in. We've built this in Looker Studio and it's free for anyone to use. The best part of building this in Looker Studio is we don't need access to your data. When you open the dashboard and open this up, you'll see all the GA4 properties that you have access to, and we don't need to see them. You can also make a copy of this dashboard by clicking the three dots here and then clicking Make a Copy, and you can save it to your own Google account for your use. This video is a companion to the resource on kpplaybook.com where we go into each chart in depth. Make sure to read that over if you have more questions. There are 5 pages in this dashboard. They're each covering a different aspect of your GA4 data. Let's start with acquisition. A common issue we see with acquisition data is poorly managed sources and mediums, which can result in your traffic getting lost in the dreaded unassigned channel. Unassigned is what GA4 calls any traffic that doesn't match their default channel groups. This was called other in UA, and is where good traffic often disappears in a sea of unrelated sources and mediums. Realistically, there should really only be 10 to 20 mediums that you see in this first chart here. Any more than that, and you're more likely to run into data consistency errors. In the next chart here, we want to look at whether or not you have uppercase letters in your sources or mediums. GA4 is case sensitive, which means it does not combine uppercase and lowercase versions of the same word. As far as GA4 is concerned, newsletter with a capital N and newsletter with a lowercase n are 2 completely separate, unrelated words. And this isn't just a GA4 issue. It's been an issue for as long as we've had Google Analytics. The best way to avoid running into this problem is to only use lowercase UTM parameters in your URLs. And the next chart here deals with whether or not you're separating paid social from organic social. One very nice new feature in GA4 is the existence of a paid social channel. This is something you would have had to set up manually in UA, so we're really excited that it's built in now. If you're running any social ads, you should see 2 channels listed in this table, organic social and paid social, but it looks like the site isn't running any paid social ads. But if they were, and they didn't see paid social here, they would definitely need to fix that. GA4 does not know if someone came to your site via a social ad or not, unless you tell it via a UTM parameter. And then last on this page, how many sessions are unassigned? As we mentioned earlier, unassigned is what GA4 calls any traffic that doesn't match your default channel groups, and is where good traffic often disappears in a sea of unrelated sources and mediums. You do not want traffic to end up here. Now, what you do see in this chart, though, is a source-medium combination of not set and not set. Why is some traffic showing up as not set? What does that mean? Julius at Analytics Mania has a nice overview of some possible issues, but if you aren't using the measurement protocol or audience triggers, and you'd know if you were using these things, and you know your UTM parameters are solid, then it may be due to a missing session start event in GA4. But it's currently unclear why this is happening, so if you do see it, it should only be a very small part of your overall traffic. We'll be sure to update this video in the future if we have any more details to share on not set sources and mediums in GA4. Other than the not set issue, check for other sources and mediums in this table and revise or correct your UTM parameters accordingly. Now let's go to the next page, which is called Pages. First off, we want to know how many pages your site has. This number here is counting the number of unique page paths that were found in your GA4 in the selected time period. This probably won't equal the number of pages you actually have on your website, since not every page of your site would be visited every single day, and if it is, let us know your secrets. But it definitely shouldn't be higher than the actual number of pages on your website. If it is, that means you're probably running into case or query parameter issues on your site that need to be resolved. First, let's look at whether or not you have case issues. This is the first possible problem related to the case sensitivity issues in acquisition. You can run into the same problems with your pages if your website's content management system doesn't force all your URLs to be lowercase. And you can see here there's a whole bunch of title case URLs going on. You don't have to use lowercase if you wish, but you do want to make sure it's consistent. We have some clients where their CMS forces them to use title case, like what's probably happening with this site here. It's unusual, but it's consistent, and that's what matters. If you see page paths listed here and you don't have a CMS that's forcing lowercase or title case, or hopefully not uppercase, that's a little aggressive, then you'll want to either fix that issue in your CMS or force your data to lowercase before sending it to GA4. The next chart looks at whether or not you have query parameters showing up in your page paths. This is also website specific. Your website might use query parameters and URLs for specific pieces of functionality, such as a search or a filter, and if so, you'll see lots of page paths show up here. Whether or not this is a problem for you depends on how your site is built. We have some examples of when this could be an issue on our website at kpplaybook.com. Now let's scroll down and take a look and see if you're collecting personal information. Luckily, Google is not. Remember, you cannot collect personal information in Google Analytics, no exception. But sometimes a website might be passing personal information in a URL, and then GA4 will dutifully record that information, resulting in personal information inside of Google Analytics. In this table, we'll show any page paths with query strings that contain an at symbol and dot characters, which can indicate an email address. We've seen this happen with systems such as booking systems, and the developers just weren't aware. If you do see any information in this table, you'll need to fix the problem that's sending data to the GA4 in the first place, and then you'll need to submit a data deletion request. And then last on this page, what pages are not found? 404 errors. This table assumes that the title of your 404 page contains not found. If that isn't the case, make a copy of this dashboard, and you can do that by clicking the three dots up here and clicking make a copy, and then you'll want to edit this chart to change it to the same title as your own 404 pages. Let's go to the next page. That's events and conversions. Events are the heart of GA4. What pages are viewed, purchases that are made, where a visitor started on your website, all based on events. That's why it's critical to ensure that your event configuration is consistent and makes sense, not just to yourself, but to anyone else who might also be looking at your analytics in the future. This page will help you see if your events are following an established naming structure, and if you have near duplicate events or incorrectly recording events that might be tidied up. In this first table, let's see how many events you're recording. While you can have up to 500 events in GA4, you probably don't actually need to use 500 events in GA4. Use this table to check for near duplicate names. For example, we've seen where people have put in scroll versus scroll down, something uppercase, lowercase, misspellings, and other issues that can cause you to have more events than you should. Then in these charts on the right, we'll see how your total events are trending over time and how your conversions are doing. You'll use these charts to look for big changes in the number and volume of events or conversions you're capturing. If you see the total number of events or conversions going up significantly, for example, you can see the conversions going up significantly here, but the number of unique events didn't necessarily change, which in this case, it does look like there might be some more unique events, but not quite in the same time period, you might have issues such as something as changing your website, and now you're creating too many events accidentally. For example, we've seen this in cases where we're tracking, say, clicks of a specific button, and then a developer changed all the buttons on the website to appear the same, and now we're recording way more events than we meant to. Now let's go to the next page, that's overall data quality. Are you collecting data from your staging and test domains? We want to avoid sending data from staging or test domains to your live/production GA4 property, as tests such as developers checking form fills, your team editing content, and so on can skew your analytics data, especially on lower volume websites. This table shows you all the host names that sent traffic to your GA4 property. If you're seeing staging, test, or unrelated domains in this table, you might want to change how data is sent to GA4. We typically use a lookup table variable in Google Tag Manager to choose which GA4 property to send data to based on the host name. If you're not sure how to do this, we'll definitely add a video on this topic in the future. Now let's look at whether or not you have self-referral issues. You'll enter your own domain name into the search box here and hit enter and see if anything shows up in the list. Make sure to only enter in the host name, don't enter in slashes or the http://part. One important thing to note about self-referrals is that sometimes it can be a sign of something else wrong with the data, not necessarily an analytics problem, but something wrong with your website. Maybe a page is missing the tracking in the middle of a checkout flow. This is really common on Shopify where users will disappear and then reappear in your website. Make sure to investigate where those self-referrals are coming from before you make any changes. Now let's scroll down and see if Google Ads is linked correctly. If you use Google Ads, don't forget to link it to GA4. If you have successfully linked it to, you should see ad groups in this table. In this case, we do see there's an ad group, but the name is not set. This means that Google is sending Google Ads data to this property, but it isn't linked up correctly. If you do see ad group names show up in this table, you can compare the number of sessions shown in this table against your click data in Google Ads. It won't match up perfectly, but it should be somewhat similar. If it isn't, you'll need to find that missing traffic, such as landing on redirects that might be stripping referrer details, or using landing pages that are missing GA4 tracking. Finally, let's take a look and see if you're collecting demographic information. If you turned on Google Signals, you should see demographic data here, including gender, age, and interests. This section is intended to check if Google Signals data is being collected if it's turned on. Not everyone can use Google Signals, and you should check with your own privacy regulations in the geographic areas that you serve before you turn on Google Signals. Now let's head to the last page. On our last page here, we're talking about e-commerce. Of course, if you don't have an e-commerce website, you're not going to see any data showing up on this page. That's okay. If you have an e-commerce website and you've set up e-commerce tracking, you should see data here. That's what you want. I also want to quickly address a revenue issue in GA4 if you don't use US dollars as your currency. GA4 does a really odd thing where it converts your revenue amount to US dollars and then back into your currency when you view the data. That will result in changes between the currency collected from your customers and what you end up seeing in GA4, especially if you transact in a currency that has rapid fluctuations against the US dollar. This is a really weird decision by Google, and we hope that GA4 changes this behavior in the future. The first three tables on this page are looking at accuracy. Are your transaction counts correct? Are there duplicate transactions? And are there test transactions? In this first table, we want to check the number shown in this table versus what you're seeing in your e-commerce software. These numbers should be relatively close. In this case, I find it unlikely that they didn't have any transactions for the last several days, so clearly something is off. Now, remember too that some people can block analytics from running in their browser if they have an ad blocker. So you may see, and you should probably see, more transactions in your e-commerce software than you will in GA4. The difference between those two numbers would be the percentage of people who are using ad blockers. As for duplicate transactions, this was a common problem in Universal Analytics, but GA4 does prevent duplicate transaction IDs being recorded by the same user. However, if you have issues with duplicate transaction IDs issued to multiple users or other configuration issues, you will see transactions in this table. As for test transactions, if you're collecting data from staging your test domains, you'll end up with more transactions you should in your reports. You definitely want to avoid that. Just make sure to check the host names here and make sure it's only your live sites that you're seeing show up in this table. Now let's scroll down a little bit and take a look at your shopping funnel. This funnel is built in GA4 events, and you can see the list of these events in the resource posted on our website. You should see a typical funnel progression from steps 1 to 6, where it starts up large and gets small over time. In this case, you can actually see that step 2, add to cart, is significantly lower than begin checkout. That means something is probably wrong with the configuration on this website, and you're not sending enough add to cart events, so that would be a place to look for sure. On the right, now let's see if there's any referral attribution issues. Similarly to what we talked about in the overall data quality, you really want to make sure that you're not sending your own domain as the referral for a transaction. If you see your own website, PayPal, Stripe, that sort of thing, that means that there's a configuration issue that needs to be corrected. Now let's scroll down and see if your product and item data is correct. If you're using product lists in your e-commerce tracking, make sure that your list names and click-through rates, your CTRs, are showing up correctly in this table. If you commonly see CTRs of over 100%, or in this case, 0%, you may not be recording view item list events properly. Similarly, if you're using the view promotion event, you should see data in this table here on the right. With click-through rates that are more than 0%, this light definitely has a configuration problem going on. And then finally, the last table, is your product data correct? This table contains all your product level data that GA4 has recorded. Look at your item names and your item categories, make sure they make sense and they're correct. And then for the metrics, what you want to check is to see if the data makes sense. For example, if you have an item view metric of 0, but you see items added to cart or checked out, your view item event isn't working correctly. Also, the items checked out and the items purchased metrics may sound the same, but items checked out is the number of items that were in the cart during checkout, and the items purchased is the number of this specific item that was purchased. And of course, don't forget what I said earlier about revenue if you transact into currency other than US dollars. And that concludes my tour of the audit dashboard. If you have further questions or ideas on what you'd like to see included in this dashboard, please get in touch. And if you want to learn more about GA4, check out our free GA4 course on YouTube or join the waitlist for our Analytics for Agencies course.